Good morning. Are you glad to be here together to worship this morning? Would you stand together with us and we give thanks to our mighty God as we worship Him today? He will give us strength as we rise in worship together.
Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up. Upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, our God. You reign forever, our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God.
We sang, the Lord comforts us in the time of need. We all have a time of need, but we turn to Him who is our eternal God, and we worship Him.
You are the everlasting God, the everlasting God, the everlasting God. Everlasting, you are the everlasting God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up.
Praise that He is the everlasting God. We thank Him because Isaiah says that the everlasting God, He does not faint, He does not become weak, and He is strength to those who are in need. That's all of us, right? All of us are in need. God bless you. You may be seated. We welcome you to worship here in South River, and we pray, God, that we can celebrate the freedoms that He has given us. And we can gather to worship as the body of Christ. As the body of Christ. That's what He's called us to as believers. He's brought us into His body. The body doesn't separate itself, the parts from one another, right? And so that picture is that we have unity and we function all together. And so that's what we gather here together to do as we worship the Lord this morning. We enter into our time of worship seeking the Lord, and we do that with our whole hearts, whether you want to come to the altar and do that or stay right there in the pew, bow the knee on Facebook Live if you want to bow in your living room or where you are. But we want to seek the Lord and realize that He is our strength in every circumstance. Pastor Stephen, would you come and lead this time of prayer, and let's come before the Lord and seek Him because he says when we seek him that he will be found, and he will show himself strong and mighty.
Good morning. Let's pray. Father, you are so good to us. And I thank you, Lord, for a morning like this one, where we can rejoice over the life that you've given us. Not the life that we're worried about that we may lose, but Lord, the life that you have given us and the life that you've given us abundantly. Father, I pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ. That's all across America. Lord, I pray for our nation. Lord, she is a great and beautiful nation, but Father, I pray that we can remember during a time such as this that we need a great king, and Lord, you are that great king. So Father, I pray that this morning, Sunday morning, that we can celebrate the life that we have in you. Lord, I praise you for the salvations that we've seen in the past few weeks. Lord, I praise you for the opportunities that we've had here through South River Baptist Church. Lord, I thank you for just allowing us just to be your hands and your feet, Lord, reaching out to a community that is in dire need. Lord, thank you for choosing weak vessels such as us to make your name great. Lord, I pray that you'll continue to use this service, that, Lord, you'll use this time of prayer, this time of singing and worship, this time of preaching of the word, Lord, to continue to transform our lives so that we can better glorify you. Lord, I pray that you'll use this week and give us opportunities to be ministers of your word to those who are in our community. Lord, I pray for my brothers and sisters right now who are struggling. Lord, some who are at home, and Lord, they're anxious, and Lord, they just need your comfort, that comfort that surpasses our understanding. Lord, that comfort that finds us in our darkest moments, in those deep valleys. Lord, you are that good shepherd who guides us out of them. So, Father, I pray that for my brothers and sisters. Lord, I pray for those who may have lost someone. Lord, I pray for the Speaks family, Lord, that you'll comfort them during their time of loss. Lord, I pray for the Susan Boyd and her family and the passing of Sam Lawrence. Lord, I pray for Jennifer and for Lori and their families, Lord, that you'll just bless them with that comfort that they need today, Lord, that you'll continue to guide and direct them from this loss, Lord, and that you'll show them that if we have you in our hearts, that we have eternal gain, that we have eternal glory, that we can praise you for all of eternity. Lord, I pray for my brother Jody this morning, Lord, who had to go through surgery last night. Lord, I know that he may be in pain, and Lord, I know that he may be struggling, Lord. I just pray, Father, that you'll give him the comfort that he needs. Father, I pray that if it's your will, that you will grant him healing. That, Lord, that you'll help him to recover from the surgery that he had to have. That, Lord, that he can continue to glorify you and be a minister that you've called him to be. Lord, I thank you for the baptism that we're going to see today. Lord, I thank you for my brother Austin, and Lord, that he can spend the rest of his life glorifying you and giving you honor and praise. Lord, I pray that you'll build him up into being a young man that will be a mighty warrior for you. Thank you, Lord, for all you do, and I thank you, Lord, for my brothers and sisters that's here in this room with us. Lord, I pray that you'll comfort us, and Lord, let us just seek your face through word and truth. We love you. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Stephen. Now we come to this time where we welcome one another and greet one another. We are so blessed that many folks are with us on Facebook Live, and then we have many guests that are here right in this place of worship together with us. We ask that guests remain seated, if you would, and all our South River folks stand and greet one another. If somebody puts out a hand and the person that is reaching the other direction doesn't want to shake it, then please don't be offended by that. But let's make it one another feel welcome in every other way, and let's celebrate that God is in our midst and we are seeking him, and we're glad that we're all here together to worship the Lord today.
If I had my ears in still. That goes well at Bristol. That's track and everything. And up over there. Alright.
let's gather back together. Guests, you can go ahead and stand with us. Thank you for allowing us to recognize where you are and to greet you. And we hope that you feel welcome in this time of worship. We come before the Lord this morning and we recognize that He is the fountain of our lives. He says, He tells us in His Word that He has placed a fountain of the Spirit of God in us. And life should be lived with that fountain flowing outside of us. And so we come before Him. We know today as we worship that our hearts are laid before Him. And we seek Him for every blessing, every need that we have, we trust Him with. And we know that we receive it as a gift from His hand. So let's seek Him as we continue to worship this morning.
Come now, fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing Thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of Thy grace. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. The mountain fixed upon it, mount of Thy redeeming love. I was lost in utter darkness till You came and rescued me. I was bound by sin when Your love came and set me free. Now my soul can sing a new song. Now my heart has found a home. Now Your grace is always with me, and I'll never be
day. We are debtors to the wonderful grace of God.
Oh, to grace, how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let Thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to Thee. Prone to wander, to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for Thy courts of love.
Yes, He takes our hearts and He seals them for all eternity.
Come Thou King.
We are in His grace, and thank God that every day and every moment He blesses us with His presence. You may be seated as we turn our attention to one we celebrate with Austin today. As he says, I've received the grace of God, and I testify to that right now in baptismal waters.
Amen. We gather this morning to worship a great mighty God who has bound our hearts to Him, and sometimes we sense that, Lord, we may be wandering away, but praise God, He's always faithful. And today Austin comes to declare his faith in Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. If there are any family or friends or Awana teachers or Sunday school teachers that want to stand with Austin as he declares his faith in Christ through believer's baptism, we always ask you to do that at this time. But Austin, you come this morning. Austin, this morning, do you come declaring before all these gathered here this morning that you believe Jesus died, that he was buried, and that he rose again?
Yes.
And Austin, just as we talked about, this water doesn't make us clean. It can't wash away the sin in our life. Only one thing makes us acceptable to God. Only one thing washes away our sin. And what is that?
Jesus' blood.
Jesus' blood. Now, Austin, are you telling all these people, not just you believe Jesus died and was buried and rose again, but that he died for you and you want him to be your Savior and your Lord?
Yes.
Austin, based on your profession and faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it's my privilege to baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We're buried in likeness to his death and raised to walk in newness of life. Amen. All it takes is childlike faith. Doesn't matter how old you are, all it takes is childlike faith, believing that Jesus died on a cross, not for the whole world, but for you. We all have to forsake all and trust in him, and that's a choice that we have to make, each one. And today that invitation is open to any and all who will come and say, I need Jesus to be my Savior and my Lord. Pastor Paul.
Would you stand with us again as we continue to worship and thank the Lord that one day we will bow before him and we won't be there because of any righteousness of our own, but only because of what Christ has done and because we have trusted our faith in his name alone. Listen to this first verse as Abigail leads out, and then we'll join together in worship to the Lamb of God.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Yeah. With all creation I sing. Hashtag wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Yeah. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Yeah. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Amen. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you. Thank you that one day we will bow before you and adore you for all eternity, because your name is above every name, and it's by that name that we are saved. It's by your name, your blood that you shed on the cross for us, that we have forgiveness and we have eternal life. And then, Lord, you bless us by sealing us with the Spirit of God in us. It seals us to that day of redemption. Lord, as we celebrate you today, Lord, may we celebrate life. And Lord, may we have a message of life in us that would cause us to open our mouths and speak boldly that message of life to others. So many are seeking life, not death, but life. They're afraid of death. But God, you have enabled us to not be afraid of death, because we've died to ourselves and we're born again and live again through the resurrection of Christ. So, Lord, help us as we continue to celebrate, as we continue to worship today, to be those who are tied to the cross, tied and completely dependent on the grace of God every moment. Lord, we need you. We need you. As we worship today, Lord, we need you to enable us to trust, to have the faith to live on in this world, because that's where you have us, strangers and pilgrims in this land. Lord, thank you. Thank you for your love for us. It's so amazing. We praise you and worship you in Jesus' name. Amen. We look at our Facebook Live crowd this morning, and we thank you for joining us. We also have the opportunity for you to give online, as the river still flows. So as we're giving here, right here in this place of worship, you can do that as well. And we thank the Lord for that opportunity.
Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. Knowing not it was for me he died on Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned, then I trembled at the Lord. Till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. There your mercy and your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied to me. There my burdened soul found liberty. At Calvary.
true salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. And your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied to me. There my burdens all found liberty at Calvary. There my burdens all found liberty at Calvary.
Thank you, praise team, and praise God for Calvary this morning. Amen. Burdened souls find liberty at Calvary. That's the message of the church. It's the message of the church in this day and age, as so many souls are burdened right now. The children are heading off to study God's Word this morning, and I hope you have your copy of God's Word, because I want us to turn to another song in the Old Testament that we're still going to sing tonight, hopefully, or this morning. Hopefully you're singing it in your heart and in your mind, as your hope and faith and trust is trusting in the Lord and looking to Him. We're in the Psalms, Psalm 42 this morning, and Psalm 43. Actually, we're going to do two Psalms because they're tied together and they speak to what's going on in our day and in our age. As Americans are in despair or moving towards desperation, you see it outside the governor's house, you see it as they're protesting in state capitals, you see it as 40% of San Diego residents are lining up at the food bank for groceries. Businesses that are built over a lifetime are gone. Desperate individuals postponing even medical treatments for cancer and other procedures because they're in despair about catching a virus. And desperate individuals that are caught up with everything that the media is just blasting into our ears as we're cooped up at home for 6-7 weeks now, and trying to figure out when we get to get life back to normal. They're going to encourage you to have a new normal, and I want you to think about that for a moment. What is that going to look like? You see, when we read these songs this morning, they're songs where the psalmist is singing in desperation. He's crying out to God. Perhaps you're doing that here this morning. Perhaps you're doing it online. Crying out for God. Why is this happening? What is going on? When will things be back to normal? How do you sing? Listen, not just a song about despair, but a song of desperation for God to do something. So many people are singing about despair, but they're not desperate yet for God to do something. Soren Kierkegaard said this: despair is when you fall out of alignment with God. And that's what's happened in America. Our nation was not in alignment with God. And God is shaking it up and trying to get our attention to realize you need to get things back in line with me. That won't happen until we become desperate enough for God to do something. And I think we're not desperate enough yet. You say, Pastor, I'm pretty desperate. I'm ready for these kids to go back to school. I didn't know I signed up to be a homeschool teacher. I'm saying we're not desperate enough to cry out to God, to beg Him to change things. I mean, yes, we've all made some changes in our schedules at home. We've retooled, we've reworked some things, and we're trying to navigate life right now, but are we really crying out to God? Entering into the prayer closet? Crying out for God to do something in our lives and in our nation? I just believe the Creator is shaking up the creation and saying, I'm here, and you're out of line with me. But I invite you to get back in line with me today. And for our world and our nation who are in despair, we have the message for them. The opposite of despair is hope. And at the core of our faith is a message of hope. A message of hope that, listen, there is actually purpose in suffering. Suffering is redemptive, though we don't think about that when we're going through suffering times. There's hope for those who are weak, because the word and the message of the Bible is you can find strength in Almighty God. You see, there's peace that He offers for those who are anxious in their spirit and are fretting and fearful and wondering and wringing their hands. There's peace that He offers. There's hope. In fact, there's mercy and grace this morning for those who are sinners recognizing, I need a Savior. I need someone to transform my life. That's our message as the church. We have the message of hope. But what happens when the church fails to bring the message of hope to the world around her? What happens when the church closes its doors and closes its ministry opportunities in the prime time when we can go and bring the message of hope? Have we forgot that our God is in control? Have we forgot that He is sovereign and on His throne? And beloved, we're all walking through the valley of the shadow of death, whether we realize it or not. Some are on the broad path that leads down. Psalm 49, death is shepherding them all the way to the grave. Others are climbing up that hill, realizing that we're on our path, that narrow path, and we know the one who is the resurrection and the life shepherding us. People aren't desperate yet enough for God. They're growing in their desperation, but I don't believe yet that they're desperate for God. Because when they are, they'll fall on their faces and they'll cry out to Him and they'll say, God, do something. I don't think we're there yet. Maybe that's why God has said, you know what? Though these governors don't have the right to do this, there's a higher law in the land, sorry, Governor Cooper, to close churches. Maybe God has said, you know what? My people aren't desperate enough to go back. They're not desperate enough for me. Maybe God's trying to wake up the church. You know, judgment does begin at the house of God. It begins with us, that we get our lives right with God, and then God helps us to be a witness, a brighter light to the world around us. You see, what is the message that we're supposed to carry to the world that's in desperation? We're supposed to bring a message of hope. And that message is that we once were desperate people, but we cried out to God. And He met us where we were in our desperation. And we discovered, man, He's everything. He's everything that I need. And forsaking all, I trusted in Him. Now you see, it's not just the world that experiences moments of desperation. You go through the Old Testament, you find examples of Old Testament saints, even New Testament believers, that in moments of desperation cried out to God. They didn't always walk on the mountaintop. Sometimes they were down in some deep, dark valleys. And they had to look up. Sometimes they were looking within, like old Elijah. Even after a major spiritual victory on Mount Carmel, he ran and hid in a cave. And in that moment, it was the whisper of the Spirit of God that finally got his attention. And he realized, you know, I've got 7,000 that haven't bent the knee. What are you doing? Jeremiah found himself in the deep, dark well, rebuking godless leaders of Judah who would not listen to the counsel of God, the Word of God, and repent. He found himself having to cry out to God, the Word becoming a fire in his bones at times. Even David here in Psalm 42 and 43, listen to this, a man after God's own heart, and yet, wait till you hear what he has to say. Desperate for God to do something. You see, we're not immune to moments of desperation as a church. The question is, will we despair because of the circumstances, or will we look to God and ask him to do what only he can do? That's where I believe we find ourselves today as a church. We have the message of hope, which is the antidote to despair. It is the cure. And yet, if we're silent with that word, then no wonder our whole community and country grows in desperation. Well, how do we get realigned with God? Well, the psalmist here has these two psalms. It's interesting because you say, why are we doing two psalms today? Because it's three stages of desperation that you see as he walks through these songs. In fact, you could wed these two together. You'll see the common refrain at the end of each section. A reminder us that this is how you get back to being realigned with God. Stand with me in honor of the word of the Lord this morning. I want us as a church to be desperate for God. Desperate for God, that's a play on words. Not desperate in our situations, but desperate for him. That's how we're supposed to be living each day. Your life, my life, demanding a supernatural explanation because we're trusting in him and looking to him because he's the only one that can meet us where we are and give us hope. As the deer pants for the water brooks, so pants my soul for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? My tears have been my food day and night, while they continually say to me, where is your God? When I remember these things, I pour out my soul within me, for I used to go with the multitude. I went with them to the house of God with a voice of joy and praise, with a multitude that kept a pilgrim feast. Why are you cast down, O my soul? Why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him for the help of his countenance. Father, our eyes look up to you. May your face shine upon us, your countenance, O God, that we are living in such a way, desperate for you, that we realize only you can satisfy our souls. Only you can supply what is needed in this day that we live. Only you, Lord, can give us victory in life. God, I pray that your spirit would move in such a way, Lord, on the hearts of all those who are under the sound of my voice right now, whether it's here in this sanctuary, online, or on the radio. Dear God, I pray that your spirit would speak to them and that all of us, Lord, might assess where we are with you. God, if we find ourselves in desperation about the circumstances in which we find ourselves, God, may we seek to know whether we are desperate for you to make things right in our lives and then in this world. God, if that isn't right, then God, today make it right, we pray. In Jesus' name and for his sake. And all God's people said amen and amen. The psalmists express a moment of desperation, a moment of depression. Three phases that he walks through here in Psalm 42 and 43. We read the first section. When there is a spiritual drought in his life, like the deer panting for the water, a soul that's thirsting to be in God's presence, a hungering, a craving, a yearning, a longing, like many who long to be back in the house of God to worship him. And may I remind you, God says you can worship him and you can gather together to worship him. You have that freedom. You have that right. It's given by Almighty God, not by the government. You see, there are moments, though, where you find yourselves spiritually wandering or wondering in the wilderness. And in those moments, God leads his people there sometimes so that they'll get a true perspective of their lives because they finally get a true perspective of him. It's a period of time when God desires that you and I grow in our faith, mature in our faith, be refined in our faith. We need to realize we'll never find satisfaction for our soul in this world in created things. A creator made us for himself. And only he will satisfy the hunger and thirst of our soul, the deep desire of our heart. We're all dependent beings, dependent upon Him. I know in America we love to celebrate our independence, but the truth is we need Him. We desperately need Him, and we desperately need Him today. The amazing thing is that in the spiritual drought that you may find yourselves in, there's an invitation from God. Isaiah 55 would say it this way: "Come, all who thirst, come to me. Drink freely without cost." That's amazing, gracious offer that God gives to anyone today to find satisfaction in Him. You don't have to reach in your pocket and give Him anything. He's done it all graciously for us. How do you overcome these moments of spiritual drought, though? How do you embrace that free invitation so that you can experience the living water that Jesus promises? Church, we're supposed to be having that living water flowing in our lives in a spiritual drought right now in our land. In a time of desperation, we're supposed to be filling, just bubbling up out of us, this message of hope that we have in Christ. You see, the problem oftentimes when we're in our spiritual drought is that we're feasting on our feelings. My soul, it says here in verse 2, my soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before Him? My tears have been my food day and night. Many are upset, crying, shedding tears over what used to be, because those things aren't there. They're trying to figure out how things are going to be. So many are gripped by their feelings that they're drinking their tears. You'll drown in those if you stay in that position. God says that He takes your tears, my tears, and He puts them in a bottle. He's mindful of them. He knows what it's like because He put on this stuff called flesh. And He walked on this earth. And He's inviting you and inviting me to look to Him and trust in Him. And not to be in despair, but in desperation, cry out to Him. You know, whenever God is present, He banishes sorrow from His presence. That's what the book of Revelation teaches us over in chapter 6, verses 15 through 17. That in the presence of God, sorrow is no longer there. He takes care of it. Tears are no longer there. He takes care of it. Why then, if God's Spirit dwells in us, why do we entertain it? Maybe it's that we're out of alignment with God and we're trying to make sense of our world because we're the center of it rather than making Him the center of our world and aligning our lives around Him. So many feast on their feelings, looking within instead of looking up to Him. Some sit there and entertain worldly thoughts, and that's why they're going through a spiritual drought. You see, He says it this way: while they continually say to me, verse 3, where's your God? You see, there were those that were sneering and mocking David. We don't know when this happened. But they're asking, you're the man after God's own heart. Where is He to deliver you? Why are you going through these hardships? Why are you going through these difficulties? That's the message of the world at all times. They did it to Noah. By the way, Peter says they'll do it at the end of times. They'll ask believers, where's your God to deliver you? And they'll mock and they'll sneer. And if you and I have an ear to hear what the world has to say and we don't listen to what the Word has to say, I'll tell you, you'll go through a spiritual drought. In fact, right now, may I just say and encourage you, if you are inundated with what the media is having to say about the COVID-19, turn off the TV. Quit listening to what the world has to say about it and look and dig into God's Word and hear what God has to say about it. Because what God has to say about it is that, listen, you don't have to fear death. Why? Because He's the resurrection and the life. You don't live in a spirit of fear because God hasn't given that. If you're living in a spirit of fear, then you know what that means? You're not in alignment with God. I know that's blunt. That may step on your toes, but it's the truth. Because God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love and of power and of a sound mind. Think rightly by listening, orienting your understanding of what's going on based on what God says, not what the world says. David is in that moment where he's listening to what the world is chiming in. Where's your God? Where's your God? You know what happens when you play that tape over and over and over in your mind? You start asking yourself, where is God? Where is God? Does He love me? Is He in control? Is He going to work all this together for good? This isn't good that I'm going through right now. Instead, we're supposed to be crying out to Him, looking to Him, and putting our hope in Him. You know what else will cause spiritual drought in your life? When you remember the good old days and you look back at the past. That's what he was doing. When I remember these things, I pour out my soul. What things? Well, he used to go with the multitude. He used to go with them to the house of God with the voice of joy and praise, with a multitude that kept a pilgrim's feast. We're not sure what's happened in this moment. We don't have the historical context of it, but clearly David is prevented from being in the presence of the Lord there at the tabernacle or at the temple, to the place of worshiping. He's unable to gather with other pilgrims who went to the tabernacle to worship God, and that's causing pain and sorrow for him. And I know right now many aren't able to go, some that are in certain medical conditions, and it's not wise, the doctors say. But can I just say this frankly? We've listened to the world and their models so much, and they're wrong, flat wrong. And all that has happened is you've been scared to death by statistics when they're not even accurate. And may I say that we need to get to the truth of the matter, because the lies and the deception are destroying lives. Some people, David is looking back saying, oh, I wish I could be in the house of God. I wish I could be with God's people. I wish I could go on pilgrimage. I wish I could be there to worship. And there are many people saying, man, I long to be back in the house of God. I got a text message this morning from someone in Charlotte who said, someone told me that you still have church open. Oh, to be in the house of the Lord this morning to worship. You see, because God's people were made for corporate worship. Do you realize the church that was persecuted in the book of Hebrews said it's important that we not forsake the assembling of the brethren together. We need one another in times such as this. The church is always gathered in the face of the shadow of death. She's never been afraid of that. And she's taken the message of hope that we believe and taken it to the world around us. David finds himself, for some reason, in a moment of spiritual drought, trying to make sense of what's going on, feasting on his feelings, hearing what the world has to say, looking back on the good old days. You know, the older we get, the less we enjoy change, right? And yet it's a reality of life. Things are going to change, by the way, whenever the new normal comes. Just get ready for it. Don't grumble and complain about it. God's still in control. We need to look to him. How do you overcome this spiritual drought? Well, he says this, get your eyes off yourself and get your eyes on God. Why are you cast down, O my soul? Why are you disquieted within? See, that's the problem. I've discovered the deeper I look within, it's just darker, darker, and darker in me. The moment I look up at him, things change. Why are you disquieted? Why are you disquieted within? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him for the help of his countenance. He's going to repeat this refrain in verse 5, down in verse 11, and then over in chapter 43 and verse 5, three times. By the way, that's a healthy exercise. Sometimes you need to step on your own toes and preach to yourself when you're not in church on Sunday, and preach sometimes the same message to you. Why are you disquieted? Why are you down? Are you looking within or are you looking up? Especially with all that you're inundated with from the media around you. And from the neighbors and from others who even sneeringly mock, where's God in all this? You need to look to him to overcome spiritual drought. Now what's amazing is he moves from a moment where there's an absence of water to where there's an overwhelming amount of water. He moves from a moment of spiritual drought to a time when he says, I'm spiritually drowning. I will say to God, my rock, I'm sorry, verse 6. Oh my God, my soul is cast down within me. Therefore I will remember you from the land of Jordan and from the heights of Hermon, from the hill Mitzar. Deep calls into deep at the noise of your waterfalls. All your waves and billows have gone over me. Imagine. Just the rushing water coming down and wave after wave just slamming into you. It's the opposite of what he said in verse 1, where there was an absence of water. He was panting. I've got a thirst for God and it can't be satisfied. Now he's overwhelmed. It's kind of like when you go to the beach and and you stand there just inside the waves, and you sink your feet down in the sand, and one wave after another just hits you, and you can withstand a few, but as that tide rolls in, you get sunk, you try to anchor your feet a little bit deeper, and that wave starts to hit you and hit you and hit you, and then finally you just fall over, right? That's the picture where he's at. The waters that flow down from the high land of Jordan, from the heights of Mount Hermon down, they're these wave after wave just hitting him, and he's saying, I'm overwhelmed by it. I'm overcome by it. What do you do in those moments? What do you need to realize? What do I need to remember so that we can overcome even those moments? Well, the psalmist says right here, you and I need to remember the waves belong to our God. He's in control. You see, deep calls unto deep at the noise of your waterfalls. All your waves and billows have gone over me. Can I say sometimes we look at our circumstances and we wonder, God, where are you? And he says, oh, I'm right in the midst of them. Are you looking at me? Wave after wave just hits you. They say, God, where are you? And he's right there in the midst of our circumstances. Paul would talk about this over in Philippians. He would say that you realize in chapter 2, God is working his salvation out of you and out of me, out of our lives. And you know how he does that? Through the circumstances we experience and go through. And Paul's perspective is this. When you're going through that, don't grumble or complain. But recognize you need to surrender to what God is trying to do in your life. How he uses those waves to strengthen your faith. How he uses those waves to grow and mature our faith. How he uses those waves to cause us maybe to get our eyes off ourselves and get our eyes up on him. It's part of his providence. He's in control, beloved. No matter what we're experiencing, our God is in control, and we need to trust in him. The waves all belong to him. And he has a good purpose in the waves. Do you realize the waves are there to bring glory to his name and for your good and my good? That doesn't mean the wave that we get hit with feels good, because oftentimes it doesn't. But the promise of his word is because my hope is in him, my hope is in what he tells me in the book of Romans chapter 8, that he works all these things together for good in my life. And that's part of our message of hope. That even in the midst of it, I can look up, you can look up, world, you can look up and trust in him. In your desperation, in your despair, and know he's in control. You have to remember also, God loves you. Because I can tell you, you're going to go through some moments where you say, this isn't the most loving thing to experience. And it'll cause some to be overwhelmed by it in that moment and feel like they're drowning. And yet, as the Lord speaks, he commands his loving kindness in the daytime, and in the night his song shall be with me. You see, his loving kindness is his hesed, a Hebrew word. It's his covenant love for his people. Beloved, God has covenanted himself to us. We are his people, and we will always be his people. Why? Because he never fails us. He never forsakes us. When he promises himself to his people, he says, you're always mine, and I'm always yours. The psalmist looks at this, and going through this difficulty, you're at your on your bed crying out, lying down, and you say, you have to cry out to God, and what God says is, I love you. I love you. I love you. He commands that loving kindness to be spoken to us in the daylight. In the dark times, he gives us the song of encouragement. But you got to be listening to the right music, the right message. The message needs to come from his throne, a message of love. How do I know God loves me? This much. He loves me this much. How? We just sang about it at Calvary. Mercy and grace was there for me. Pardon multiplied to me. My burdened soul found liberty at Calvary. It's right there for any and all who want it. He loves us this much. That's why I love Romans chapter 8 so much. A great, great section from verse 1 all the way to the end, which highlights the assurance we have as believers, no matter what we face, hardship, affliction, difficulty. Paul lists many of them. You know what? There's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. There's assurance that we have that God's working all things together for good. There's the promise that what can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus? Nothing. Nothing. So there's victory. But see, I've got to remember, He's in control. I've got to remember, He loves me. I've got to remember, He's my rock. He's my foundation. I will say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? Why do I go mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? As with the breaking of my bones, my enemies reproach me while they say to me all day long, where is your God? There's the world chiming. We don't know what caused this aggravated distress in David's life. He's crying out to God. He's being afflicted. He's going through. Someone's ridiculing and mocking him because of the circumstances where this man after God's own heart, now everything isn't going swimmingly for David. And yet he looks out and he calls out and he says, God, I'm going to remember you're the foundation upon which I stand. You are the anchor for my soul. And right now some people need to be reminding themselves of that. In their desperation, in their moments where they're drowning, in their moments where they're despairing, they need to cry out to God. And by the way, you notice David is questioning the Lord. He's crying out and asking the questions of him. That's when you and I get in the prayer closet and he really starts working on us. That's what he wants us to do, cry out to him. By the way, remember I told you Jesus put on this flesh. He knows what it means to walk like you and I did. By the way, on the cross, he asked God something. My God, why have you forsaken me? The cry of the cross, Psalm 22. Jesus knows what it's like, y'all. We need to follow his example. Look to the Lord, though. And trust in him. Cry out to him. You see, God is and will always be our rock. God is and will always be the firm ground upon which we stand. He's the stable, secure security that you and I need at this moment in our lives. When you're feeling the waves hit you, you need something firm and strong to stand on. And that's God, our rock. And then there's this fir frame all over again. Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him, the help of my countenance and my God. Now, I'm going to focus on that when we get to the third one. Why he would say this over and over again. But again, he's got to preach to himself, and you need to preach to yourself. Make sure your faith is resting in the Lord. Make sure you're looking to him. Make sure you're not looking around to the government to fix everything. I can tell you, they've messed it all up. They're not going to fix it. I wish they would realize that. Oh, dear Lord, please give them a spirit of wisdom and understanding to know the truth. That they need to cry out to you. Many of our founding fathers realized that and they cried out to God and trusted in him. Preach to yourself. Remind yourself of this. David is in drought. David is in drowning. And then David is just frankly depressed. The third moment he comes to it. Vindicate me, O God, Psalm 43, and plead my cause against an ungodly nation. O deliver me from the deceitful and unjust man, for you are the God of my strength. Why do you cast me off? Why do I go mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? You see, twice his personal inquiry has been in vain. He hasn't gotten the answers he's looking for. There's been no restoration of his well-being. Just the trouble and anxiety seem to multiply. And it just rolls back on him. Another wave hits him. Another wave hits him. The tension and pain there in verses 1 through 5 just multiply in verses 6 through 11. And now for a third time he comes back to God. And God answers him. And helps him to realize, here's how you're going to get out of this. And church, this is how we get out of it. This is the message we bring to a world around us. Right now, a message of hope in the midst of despair. What is that? Well, first, you got to look for God to defend you. And second, you got to look for God to direct you. You need God to defend you in those moments when you are under oppression from the enemy. Oh, you are the God of my strength. Why do you cast me off? Why do I go mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? We don't know when this happened, whether this was Absalom's rebellion, whether it was the moment leading up to David taking the throne. What we do know is this, is the man after God's own heart is crying out to God and saying, I'm trying to make sense of this. Why is this happening? Because I know you're my rock. I know you're my strength. I know you're my shield. I'm trusting in you. And beloved, that's what we need to realize too. God is our defender. God is the one that protects us. Beloved, can I tell you, there's many things that this world says will secure you. You can secure your home. You can secure yourself. Immunization's going to secure you from disease. No, it won't. The only thing that secures us is God Almighty. Our faith rests in Him. Our trust is in Him. They were slandering David. They were tearing down his good name. And God's response is a natural one. Or his response to God is a natural one. You go to the Lord and you cry out to Him. Why? Because He's our refuge in times such as these. Why try to fight in your own strength? I don't know. We need to realize we're impotent. We can't do anything. He's omnipotent. And we need to trust in Him. And that's where David is. And he asks, God, where are you? As many are asking even today. Have you forgotten me? Has God deserted His people? Has God deserted His saint? Has God forsaken Him? No! God's not left us as orphans. God, defend me. And God, direct me. You see, I will go to the altar of God. To God, my exceeding joy, he says. Why is he going down to the altar? Because in verse 3, he's saying, send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me and let them bring me to your holy hill and to your tabernacle. You see, God, I need you to direct me. I need you to direct me to you. You know, we sang that psalm, that song earlier, that, you know, at times our hearts are prone to wander. Why? Because we lose the wonder of who He is. And what God wants to do is bring us back to Him. And He sends out His light and He sends out His truth. That's what the psalmist says will direct you always back to God. The illuminating, glorifying presence of the Lord. How do you get that light into a moment of darkness in your soul? Right here. This is the secret. Building your life on the Word of God. This is a light unto your feet, right? A lamp unto your feet, a light unto your path. This Word reveals the glorious God. That light will help you navigate dark times. And right now, so many are listening to the darkness of the world rather than the illuminating presence of God that He reveals Himself through His Word. God, direct me, send out your light, and send out your truth. Now, the amazing thing about this source right here, it's infallible. It's inerrant. It's a source of truth. I can tell you, the world is not giving us truth. 2 million people are going to die. That's what they shut everything down based on. 2 million people are going to die. That's what the models tell us. Oh, wait, we got to change that. 200,000 are going to die. Oh, wait, we got to change that. Maybe 100,000? And you look at the devastation that's happening around the world because of this, based on a lie. Did someone intentionally lie? Okay. No, maybe they were majorly misinformed. But it wasn't truth. And yet you look at what's happening today. The only way we get back to normal is to get back to the truth. Because truth always triumphs. Right now, some truth needs to triumph and some people need to be held accountable for it, frankly. You say, man, that's bold. Well, let me tell you something. Prophets have always spoken to kings and told them the truth. Read the Old Testament and read what happened to John the Baptist with old Herod, that fox, right? Told him the truth. Some people don't like the truth. They can't handle it, right? You see, God says you need the truth, and I need the truth, because the devil is a deceiver, and the deceiver is a destroyer, and the deceiver is a destroyer, and the best way to do that is to divide. And that's exactly what's happened in the midst of all this. Divide the people, they're easier to control. Lock them in their homes, they're easier to control. This is not going where I thought it was going to go last night. But it's where it needs to go. God, defend me. God, direct me. God will direct me with light and with truth. But if you're not taking in the light and you're not listening to the truth, you're going to stay in darkness, and you're going to be depressed, and you're going to drown in your sorrows, or you're going to be in a spiritual drought. What we need to do is cry out to God, deliver me. Notice what he says. I will go to the altar of God, to God my exceeding joy, and on the harp I will praise you. O God, my God, the third time, why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him, the help of my countenance and my God. You see, three times he had to preach this to himself. Three times he had to remind himself. And finally, when he got on the altar, I believe he finally got delivered. Why? Because you see, our help will always be in the Lord and not this world. And we need to trust in him and look to him. He is a mighty deliverer. Our hope must rest in him. And that happens when we get on the altar. Because there on the altar, you bend your knee and you realize, God, I got nothing. And I can't fix this. But, oh God, you can. And I just think right now, our nation is about to go into some serious moments of desperation. I'm not a prophet of doom. This is never fun to say, but it does not look good. And as your pastor, my responsibility is to be a watchman and to warn. You have to do with the truth what you want to do with it. Your responsibility to do something with it. It's not easy saying that. But I'm telling you, as a shepherd, watching over God's sheep, beloved, it's going to get worse, a lot worse. Why? Because of the devastation and destruction that's happened to our economy and to the psyche of people. In the midst of that, we have a message of hope. In the midst of that, we're not in awe. Oh, we're in awe of him. And we go forward in faith. And we proclaim the message that we have. I love this. You can't see it in the English, but you can see it in the Hebrew. Three times he says this. Hope in God, for I shall yet praise him, the help of my countenance and my God. In the Hebrew, it says there that we look for the help of my Yeshua. 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 Y'all know what Yeshua is? Yeshua is the God of salvation. Yeshua is Jesus. That's where his name comes from. Now you can't see it in the English, but oh, it's there in the Hebrew. Oh, it's rich. Ha! For us today, right? Because we know when we look into the face of God, Jesus said what? If you want to see the Father, look at who? Look at me. Because when you see me, you've seen him. Man, I just want to see God's hand. I want to see God's deliverance. Look to Jesus. Why? Because that's where our hope is in. You see, as Kierkegaard said, so many are in despair because they're not aligned with God. And the only way you get aligned with God is to put your hope in God and trust in him. And that's what we have to do. We have to look to him. And we come to an altar called Calvary where he has said, here's every reason why you should put your hope in me. Because I love you this much. And this is how much I would demonstrate my love, that I would send my son to die for you. Trust in me. Look to me. You see, the amazing thing is this lamb that was slaughtered for you and for me, that paid the penalty for our sins, he wants to be the shepherd of our souls. To navigate life each and every day, looking to him, trusting in him. And the answer for desperate people is to hope in him. That's the message, church, that we have to share. But it doesn't just come from our lips. We've got to live it out first. And maybe right now, God is just shaking things up so that maybe the people of God will get back to the point where, God, I'm desperate for you. And I want you above all things. I've gotten things out of alignment. Maybe you need to go on the altar today. Right here in the sanctuary or right there in the prayer closet at home as you're watching on Facebook Live. And just say, God, some things are out of line. And I need to get it right today. And I look into your word, and I want the light to illumine my path and guide my steps. And God, I want to be governed by truth because it always triumphs. You see, if you're in darkness this morning, if you're drowning this morning, if you're depressed this morning, curled up on the bed and you can't get out of bed because of the circumstances, turning to the bottle, turning to alternatives to drown your sorrows, the answer is turn to Jesus. Turn to Him and look to Him. Beloved, I promise you, when you open up your mouth, He will fill it and satisfy it. Why? Because you were made for Him. And the hole that's in our hearts, only He can fill it. But you've got to look for Him in your desperation. And you know the amazing thing? God's people always live desperate. Not desperate because of the circumstances, but desperate for Him. And I believe God is bringing the church to that moment, the true church. Will we cry out to Him and say, God, do what only You can do? I'm going to invite